My topic would be something that I would like to talk about is Bhagavad Gita's train of economic wealth theory, which was initially propounded by Bhagavad Gita. So what it actually meant for the British rule and how it affected India later on. Very simply, it meant that the British, what it meant was the British did not come and rule India for 200 years, as many have later on argued. For the benefit of the colonies, especially India, the British did it for their own, to meet their own ends. Now, take into account, take into view some of the data, you understand what exactly is meant by this. When the British arrived on India's soil, India's share of the GDP was, world's GDP was only around 24%. When India left, when the British left, it was less than 4%. India's share in the global gold trade was about 27%, and the British left was less than 2%. What happened? What did the British do? How is economic, how did they drain the wealth that was there in India? Well, simply by, I take the example of India was a massive exporter of textiles, probably the world's largest exporter. It was, but as soon as the British came in, what the British did was they systematically cut down on the textiles that was available with India, on the textile trade that was available with India. They systematically broke it down, and what they did was they took over the raw materials and helped. They simply took over the raw materials, and that actually gave rise to the material mills or the dark and sinister mills that we have all heard about. So actually, Britain's industrialization is in some way is based on the deindustrialization of India, especially Bengal. Mushidabad used to garner some 5% of the world's GDP and was famous for its wool, like woven, like air, light, silk, and other textiles. So in that sense, you can understand the kind of amounts that has been drained from the Indian economy to Britain, and their rise in the 20th century was based on Indian money. Not only India, but other colonies. But then again, India's money. India was there when established cash cow. I think India was their largest market of all the British produce. So think about that. They not only systematically broke down Indian textile industry. They simply dumped all their produce on India, so that all the cash from India could be transported then to British. Put this into account with the kind of contribution that India made during, say, World War I. India supplied some 54,000 men, India supplied ammunition, guns, people, clothes, and whatnot. You know, the valuation of that in today's money would be somewhere around £8 billion, which was never really paid in full because India, of course, was a colony. It was even worse off in, say, the Second World War. After the total, and this £8 billion was actually today's money. In the case of Second World War, if you take that into account, in the case of Second World War, the total amount of money that the total amount of debt that was owed by the British was about £3 billion, out of which £1.25 billion was simply owed to India. It was never actually paid. So yeah, it's very obvious, right? Why do you pay the colony if you can liquidate your borrower? Then why bother paying it off? So this is what Dalai Lama actually wanted to propagate, that there is a huge drain of Indian wealth. The average is so bad that the average age of the average lifespan or mortality came down. Average age that Indian was supposed to be alive was came down. Somewhere from about 25 years to it came down to 19 years. It was so bad. Just and only that, just not only that, just think about the kind of famines that was induced, especially the 1943 famine. And the appalling thing was that it was Winston Churchill's policy to implement that. Winston Churchill took food grains from Bengal and transported it all the way to Johor. And it was this food grains were not transported simply because to boost the Dhamis or Yugoslavia or Sterling Greens. It was done as a buffer. It was not used in the war front. It was done to maintain a steady buffer stock. When consciously stricken British officials in Bengal wrote Winston Churchill. All he could muster was he simply peevishly asked him back, "Why hasn't Gandhi died yet?" This simply showed that India was nothing more than a cash cow. It was nothing more than a profitable business for them. And all this rhetoric of saying that they have done so much for India and all that they have done is because of some generous benevolence is utterly, absolutely, you know, pointless. Just seeing the kind of money that they have taken away from the country in the name of governance, in the name of democracy. Yeah, there is obviously a lot of people who defend this, who defend or who deny the train of wealth theory, actually say that, British have given you British have given you a democracy. Well, just to say that they have given you democracy after ruling over injury, maiming, killing, and looting and whatnot for 200 years, just to say that you have been given democracy is like, it's really pointless. And coming to the railways, they did not build the railways, because not only British, but it's not built the railway for the Indian public. In fact, fun thing is that British never even tried matching the supply of mass transportation at that time with the demand for mass transportation. All they simply did was they wanted a network to supply the raw materials from hinterland to the ports. That was all that the British wanted to do, and not one bit about transportation. All these things taken into account, and numerous more, I'm sure I missed out a lot of important points, and there will be a lot many economic factors that could be brought in, especially the kind of public private relationship during the establishment of the railways, where the entire risk was borne by the Indian public, where the returns were given to the British gentry. All this simply goes on to show that the kind of economic wealth train that India has faced, and the actual implications of Tata Mahanavaji's train of wealth theory that he propounded initially. That is all I would like to say. Thank you.